Belinda Audio presents this unabridged recording of The Valley, written by Di Morrissey and read by Kate Hood. Author's note. This is a work of fiction. All characters are creations of my imagination, with one exception. Isabella Mary Kelly lived in the Manning Valley of New South Wales in the mid-19th century, and I like to think she'd be pleased with my telling of her story, the salvaging of her reputation, and remembering her for the feisty and formidable woman she was. I have also drawn inspiration from the letters and memories of my grandparents, Jack and Louisa Revett, of Wingham, New South Wales, where I was born. I hope you enjoy my valley. Dedication. For all my family everywhere. Special hugs to my mother Kay, daughter Gabrielle and son Nick, and to Barry, welcome to the family. The Valley. The Valley was a little known gem, its undulating green landscape slashed by the magnificent river seeking the sea. Those who knew this place knew its magic. From its first inhabitants who roamed the hills, river and valley, it was a country of ceremony, corroboree and creation. Then came white settlers with horses and cattle. They carved first bush homes and found and felled the ancient trees. There were murders and births. Many died before their time. As two centuries passed, the valley remained little known. Those who came and stayed were drawn into its embrace as to a mother's breast, were comforted and made welcome, finding peace in which to live out their lives. The valley was special to all who knew it. Prologue. Kelly's Crossing, 1840. The clouds parted like a plush grey curtain, leaving a backdrop of streaky winter sky behind heavily timbered peaks. Centre stage, three figures, dwarfed by the landscape, made their way along the narrow cutting through ancient trees in a dense rainforest. The track was rough, rutted from bullock hooves, timber drays and an occasional horseman. The rolling sound of a fast-flowing creek grew louder, and soon the travellers were beside what was normally a shallow rocky crossing. They stopped at the swollen creek and took in the approach that angled gently down the bank. On the other side, the way out was a steep stretch of dangerous loose stones. It demanded determination from both horse and rider in a hard gallop from the water and up the challenging bank. The three figures moved closer to the water. Only one, a woman, was mounted. The two men on foot were ill prepared for the rough track and icy water crossing, their boots well worn, their apparel threadbare. One was leading a pack horse, and both men were tethered by ropes to the lead horse and rider. They were not countrymen, and they gazed at the water in dread. "We'll never walk this flooded creek. It'll be shocking cold and strong by the look of it," muttered the younger of the two shackled men. "It's for a hearty sailor at home in fierce water, not for the likes of us," agreed the older man. The woman on horseback heard them. "I hope you don't fancy yourselves as town gents. You two have been long enough on the island to rough your hands. We are crossing over this stream. We have a distance to travel before dark. Hold on to the ropes." The scoffing and at the same time commanding tone did not invite argument. The older of the two convicts, who was leading the pack horse, spoke in a subservient and hesitant voice. "Mom, it really is dangerous. With respect, be careful. It could sweep away the unwary." "I am not unaware of dangers. The distance across is short if we act swiftly. Get down the bank. I will loosen the ropes." The woman deftly untied the two ropes that were knotted on the ear of her saddle and led to the shackles on the ankles of the two convicts, assigned to her for the last 6 months of their sentences. She was no beauty, but a striking woman, and any man could see she was not one to be trifled with. She rode side saddle, as convention decreed, in a great sway-back leather saddle, seated as comfortably as in an armchair. Her long black skirt was looped about her legs, her booted foot firmly in the stirrup. The scarlet jacket over her modest blouse was a vivid splash of colour in the grey and sodden scene. On her head she wore a cabbage tree hat, favoured by the men of the district. The woven brim shaded her face, her hair was coiled firmly beneath the plaited crown. She had no time or taste for fashionable bonnets. In her gloved hands, she held reins and a whip. "If you lose your footing, keep your head up and kick strongly. Hang on to the rope, and it will pull you across." The black stallion braced itself for the plunge through the creek. The horse and rider had forded flooded creeks before this day. She nudged the black horse forward, and it strode firmly, the water surging around its chest. Glancing behind, the woman saw the worried faces of the men as they waded carefully, the water at their armpits. One held the rope above his head as the pack horse gamely stepped through the current. The pack horse was strong and a handy swimmer if required. If it tripped, it would be let free to make its own way through. Even a normally narrow channel such as this was not to be trusted when swollen and muddy from storms. Before the woman's attention returned to the way ahead, the stallion stumbled as a submerged log rolled underfoot, and suddenly they were in a deep hole where the current churned in a whirlpool. The horse was flung sideways, its rider wrenched from the saddle. The two men and pack horse were on firmer ground and watched helplessly as the woman was swept away. The woman's horse, holding its head high, swam strongly till it found a footing. Slipping on stones, it stepped into the shallows and charged up the steep bank, water streaming from the saddle, dragging the men in its wake. The pack horse's hooves clanged against stones, and it too scrambled from the rushing water, the younger man clutching the reins, struggling to his feet after slipping on the bank. Both men craned their necks to see what had happened to their mistress, but she was out of sight. They freed themselves from the ropes and stumbled along the creek edge, hanging onto trees until they saw a slash of red jammed into the roots of a tree toppled by the floodwaters. The woman was trying to drag herself free, but the waterlogged weight of her skirt and petticoats and the surging current kept pulling at her. The men looked at each other. Here was a chance to make away with two horses to freedom. "We wouldn't get far, lad," said the older man. "I suppose it would go bad with us when we are so close to finishing our time," the younger man whined reluctantly. "What do we do?"
"Take the small axe from the pack horse. We can cut through this tangle. Get a rope we can throw out to her."
The men worked quickly as the horses stood patiently on the bank, shaking their manes and flicking tails.
"We be getting to you, ma'am. Hang on," called the older man.
The woman's expression was grim, and although her arms were tiring as the water pulled at her clothing, her grip around the tree was firm and determined. The older man threw the rope towards her, and she caught it. He secured the other end to a nearby tree, while the younger man used the axe to swiftly cut away a barrier of shrubs and saplings on the steep bank.
"Good lad, that's enough."
He gave an encouraging smile to the trapped woman.
"Right," he called.
The woman hesitated before loosening her grip.
"It's strong, ma'am. Won't break. Hold tightly."
Trusting herself into their care, she let go of the tree and was swiftly hauled in, despite her waterlogged weight. She staggered up the bank and hastily made an effort to get to her feet and grasp at what dignity and authority remained to her. The men busied themselves with winding up the rope, stowing the axe in a pack saddle and wringing water from their clothes.
"That was fortunate and quick thinking. I am grateful," said the woman briskly. "I must find a dry jacket. My skirt will dry as we ride."
"We're moving on?" the young man asked in surprise. The woman arched an eyebrow.
"Did you imagine we would camp at this miserable crossing just because we got wet? We are expected at Port Macquarie, and we will be there on time."
She went to the pack horse as the men exchanged a look of frustration.
"We should have left her, gone on, found someone and reported an accident," said the younger man in a low and angry voice.
"You could live with yourself. I couldn't."
"But surely she won't take us to be flogged. Not now."
The younger man's face was red with anger and fear. His life had been dogged by ill fortune. Now, for the first time, having acted without self-interest, it proved to him there was no gain in honesty or decency.
"It may go easy with us now," answered the older man.
"And if not, is she so hard a woman?"
"If not, it will be over and done with quick enough," said the older man philosophically.
Seeing the woman returning in a dry jacket, taken from the saddle pack, the young man turned away, his face sullen.
"I suppose we have to be tied to the horses again," he yanked at the rope.
"Do I have your oath to stay beside me?" You can take turns on the pack horse. We must travel further to make camp before dark. Fetch the horses.
She turned to the older man as the young fellow trudged to the horses.
I will not forget what you have done this day, but I am obliged to do what must be done.
The man's face was expressionless.
Whatever you say, Miss Kelly.
She swung into the saddle and watched him help the younger man onto the pack horse.
Decide between you when to change over.
She spurred the black stallion further up the slope, paused where the track began to level, and watched the pack horse pick its way towards her. The older man followed, leaning on a stout stick salvaged from the bush litter. The young man on the horse sat with shoulders slumped and his head bowed, angrily contemplating the punishment awaiting him at the penal center that served the district. They had indeed done wrong by their employer, letting several unbranded cattle stray to be conveniently collected and bought on the sly had seemed a quick and easy way to pocket some money. Cattle were often lost in the thickly timbered hills around Miss Kelly's unfenced property, but the purchaser was found out before he could brand the cattle, and he wasted no time in pinpointing the culprits, pleading his own innocence. So in accordance with the regulations governing convict labour to free settlers, the men were to be punished as the law stipulated. But Miss Isabella Kelly was not about to put her men in the hands of the local magistrate, a man she knew despised her. She preferred to take them on a longer journey to Port Macquarie, where they'd been serving out their term before assignment. In 1843, there were no townships between her holdings at Mount George, well up the Manning River, and Port Macquarie on the Hastings River. 8 days later, the three returned the way they'd come. This time, the creek crossing presented no challenge. The water had receded, the stream gurgled pleasantly and sparkled in the sunlight. The woman did not glance downstream where she'd almost perished. It seemed to the men that she appeared not to recall that day, and rode on, apparently more interested in checking her cattle on the remote rolling hills being cleared as part of her dream to become a great and rich settler in this vast and enthralling land. Back at Port Macquarie, the story of Isabella Kelly's accident and rescue by the convicts was being told with increasing embellishment. It was growing well beyond the version given by the young convict hauled before the court, who had smarted not only from the pain of the lashes received, but also from what he regarded as the injustice of the event. There were many who shook their heads dismissively when they heard the story. The men in the colony overwhelmingly disliked Miss Isabella Kelly. To them, she was wrong to meddle in the affairs of men. Settling the land and overseeing convicts was men's business. She might be a proud woman, but she was bound to fall or fail. It was not right that a woman alone, with no kith or kin, an orphan from the old country, could better the men of the district with her cattle and horse breeding. She was an aloof and therefore mysterious figure who did not fit into the accepted ways of the new settlers. But the legend she was to become was only beginning. Sydney, 1998. Lara Langdon sat in the deep chair, hunched, trying to sink into the faded flower print as if she could disappear and escape what was happening around her. Hushed, concerned voices in another room. Cars arriving and leaving. A phone ringing. Her daughter, somber in black, came into the room looking concerned and tentative.
Go away, Danny, please. Leave me. Just go, declared Lara.
Mum, you can't stay here. You feel terrible, I know, but you have to come to the funeral. Danny pleaded gently. It'll be all right. I won't leave your side for a minute.
Her eyes were sad, her heartbreak obvious. She ached for her mother and knelt down by the chair, took her hands and gave a soft, supportive squeeze. Lara's mother, Danny's grandmother, Elizabeth, had died. Danny was trying to imagine how she would feel at the loss of her own mother, crouched there in the chair and her heart constricted.
Mum, people will think it very strange if you stay at home. At least come to the service. They'll think you didn't love her, respect her.
I've never cared what people thought, nor did she.
Now that's not true. Elizabeth cared desperately what people thought of her. She just pretended she didn't. Danny, you don't understand. I don't do funerals.
Lara's eyes blazed. Danny almost smiled. She was glad that at last something had jolted her mother out of her inert state. But then she sighed. It was true. Lara had avoided funerals all her life. Bizarre, really. She always had excuses, such as living overseas or being interstate, being bogged down in the demands of work, or faced with a domestic crisis. If only people knew how fearful Lara was of this event. The bright, irrepressible, strong woman who had done so much. But Lara, Danny's mother, was unable to deal with death. Danny remembered coming home during university holidays to find their cat lying by the front gate, killed by a swift hit from a passing car. Lara had fled inside, and it had been Danny who'd lifted the still, soft form, cradling the cat in her arms, singing and talking to their dead pet as she walked around the garden. When Gordon Langdon, her stepfather, arrived home, the two of them buried the cat beneath a pretty shrub. Lara had served dinner stony-faced and never mentioned what had happened. But Danny knew she'd watched it all from an upstairs window. Several times over the past year, she'd tried to help her mother face up to the inevitable, that Elizabeth was fading fast. But Lara had always brushed her comments aside.
"Let's not get into that. I can't bear to think about it."
Lara always had a way of deflecting the unpleasant. A flick of her hand, a twist of her head, avoiding eye contact and changing the subject with a light-hearted remark. But now Lara could not make this moment go away. She was unmoving, her eyes closed. Danny wondered what special moments she was recalling.
"Mum, there'll be time to remember things after," she said softly.
Lara opened her eyes.
"I was wondering about that man who said he'd fix the veranda awning. He never called back."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.